Time Hunter, The Severed Man, by John Paul Catton. Read by Terry Molloy. Screams. Like wretched, tortured, agonized yowls, they echo into the cold emptiness of the room. A base animal whimpering, a gurgle of pain. A needle and a hot, flickering flame. Light replacing darkness, replacing light. As if someone is staring at car headlamps, hurtling along a road. As if they're watching the flickering on a broken television set that's been tuned to a dead channel. And blood. Lots of blood. A voice is there, too. Somewhere beneath the agony, rasping a name. It is laughing at the history that is dissipating all around it, swirling away into nothingness as the darkness moves in to swallow everything. In this room here, there is only the present. A long and torturous second, stretched out and maintained aloof from time as if the rest of the universe has suddenly ceased to exist. No one can remember how they arrived, or how long they have actually been here. Only the pain and the darkness remain. A figure rises from somewhere in this darkness, but the view of it is hazy, dreamlike, as if seen from behind a veil. It stares with shining, glassy eyes at the looping time streams all around it, watching as they bubble away into the future and the past, watching as they alter ever so slightly. As the screaming comes to an abrupt halt and the ebb and flow of another existence dissolve against the persistent flow of time, dashed into fragments of nothing as if they had never actually existed. Another one cut free. Another one released from time's ticking bonds. The figure steps away, carefully laying its implements down on a surface nearby. It wipes its hands on a dirty smock and then steps towards another figure, this one prone on a bench a few feet away. Presently, the screaming starts all over again. For the tiniest of moments, the first figure hesitates, as if unsure whether or not to carry on, as if the horror of its actions has finally begun to register behind its eyes. But then it picks up its tools once again, and the blood begins to flow down its arms, pooling on the floor in large puddles of glossy red. This time the pain is different. This time it is far more acute. The figure continues to labour over its charge, sweat running down its heavily creased brow. After all, there are many others waiting to be released from their shackles. And tonight it has much, much work to do. The marketplace was deserted, ethereally quiet. Honoré Lechaussure felt the tiny hairs on the back of his neck bristle against the cold and shivered. Spitalfields was usually thronging with people, even at this late hour. Empty, it just felt wrong, somehow unnatural. He shifted his feet and blew into his cupped hands in an attempt to keep warm. The fog was thick and penetrating around him, stifling the radial glow of the street lamps. On the opposite side of the road, the scorched remains of the old church stood sentry-like against the moonlight, casting shadows across the street in wide, sweeping arcs. Around it, the remnants of splintered gravestones erupted from the soft loam, describing a shattered smile of jagged, broken teeth. The shadows would be a good place to hide. Lechaussure glanced about, trying to catch sight of his prey. He'd been tracking the boy across the capital for nearly 3 hours, only stopping to catch his breath in the stolen moments before rounding a bend or waiting to step out of a doorway. Now he was cursing himself for losing sight of the child. He stepped out into the road, listening for any sign of movement. Nothing. The marketplace was absolutely deserted. He glanced in both directions, up and down the road. The fog was everywhere, dampening the air. He'd have to start again in the morning. He sighed and turned about, ready to start the long trek back towards his lodgings. Damn boy. Then, in the quietness, he heard the scuff of a heel from somewhere behind him. He span around, catching sight of the child ducking around a corner just a few feet away, his ragged scarf fluttering behind him as he ran. Lechasseur took off after him. His heart rattled in his chest, pounding blood around his body as his legs pumped at the hard cobbles. He lurched around the corner, sure that he was only minutes away from finally ensnaring his prey. Then, as suddenly as if Hades itself had just erupted from the ground before him, the world was full of light. Lechasseur skidded to a halt and shielded his eyes from the sudden glare. It was blinding, a brilliant, hot white that emanated from somewhere or something a little further down the road. Between his fingers, he tried to make out what it was. And that was when he saw it. A figure emerging from the whiteness, like an apparition, or a tiny, fragile angel. The girl in the pink pajamas. He shrank away from the searing light, covering his face with his hands. Emily! And felt a firm hand on his shoulder, felt a faint whisper of a voice in his ear. Can you see it, Honoré? Can you see it now? The darkness consumed him once again, and he was lost in the swirling mist of fog and dreams. Emily. Lechasseur sat bolt upright on his bed, sweat running in trickling rivulets down the fold of his back. His hair was damp with stale perspiration. He glanced around the room to make sure he was still alone. Bare walls stared back at him, gloomy in the inky wash of the moonlight. He allowed himself to breathe. The dreams have been worse over the last few days, a procession of stuttering, random images that, upon waking, had left him with a sharp feeling of disquiet. But the whispering voice was new, a rasping, disturbing wheeze in his ear. He had no idea what it could mean, or to whom the voice was supposed to belong. Someone from his past? From the war? That would certainly explain the sudden flash of light, a flashback to Normandy and the explosion that saw him invalided out of service. But what it had to do with Emily, he had no idea. He tried to put it out of his mind. Lechasseur swung himself out of the bed and padded his way over to the small basin in the corner of the room. The porcelain was cold and hard against his clammy skin. He splashed some water over his face, shivering momentarily with the shock, and then buried his face in the soft, downy towel. Outside, the sounds of the city were slowly coming to life. He brushed the curtain out of the way and peered out at the streets below. It was still dark. His tired reflection stared back at him from the pane of glass like a taunt. He watched for a moment until his face was obscured by the streaky wash of raindrops being dashed against the window by the wind. In the morning, he would talk to Emily. In the morning, he would forget all about the dream, just get on with the day ahead and try not to think about sleeping. In the morning. He sat down on the edge of the bed and tried to stave off the tiredness that was creeping through his body like the slow onset of a lethargy. He had to do something about getting some sleep. 3 hours later, Lechasseur began the slow walk across town to meet Emily. She'd decided to get a room of her own, and had found somewhere she liked after a week or so of searching. It was close to Spitalfields, a place where she had been found by a policeman wandering with no name and no memory. It was just a shame it was so far from Honoré's own place. He decided not to use his bicycle, thinking that he could do with the walk. But the cold was biting into his fingers now, and he was starting to wish that he had at least brought along some gloves. He jammed his hands deep into the pockets of his leather trench coat and stepped up his pace. Around him the city was a hive of activity. Delivery vans trundled down crowded streets, whilst market traders set up their stalls by the side of the road. It was early, but Le Chasseur had been up for some time. He was not a man who kept normal hours, and, unlike most people, even enjoyed the bustle of the morning. Today he was tired, weary right down to his bones, but the fresh air was starting to brush away the residual cobwebs from the restless night before, and he could feel his mood beginning to lift. He was anxious to put an end to the bad dreams as soon as possible. He hadn't worked for over a week, and needed something to get his teeth into, to take his mind off his own personal distractions. After he'd met up with Emily, he'd pay a visit to one of his contacts over in the West End to see if there was word on any of the police cases he'd been keeping tabs on of late. Didn't hurt to stay abreast of what Scotland Yard were working on, and occasionally, when the police seemed to be dragging their heels, Honoré had found himself picking up the trail, seeing if he couldn't bring a new perspective to the situation. It had been known to pay off. He passed by an office building where the desk clerks were already hard at work inside. The tapping of their typewriters could be heard through a crack in the window, like the chattering of so many animals locked in a small pen. He smiled. Not the life for him. In many ways, London was still an enigma to Le Chasseur. The rain-soaked streets were familiar enough, of course, as were the people, the instantly recognisable cross-section of humanity that inhabited any city the world over. But it was the city itself that still left him perplexed. It was as if the road map was in constant flux, shifting about him as he slept, so that he could never work out exactly what had changed. Sometimes it was as simple as a postbox being on the opposite side of the road to where he remembered it, or yet another identical row of houses springing up in a place where he had never seen them before. But mostly it was less explicit, more to do with a feeling than anything more substantial. The city changed along with his mood, and he was unsure if he would ever get used to it. He supposed it was partly due to the extensive rebuilding that was changing the face of the city in the aftermath of the Blitz, but as much to do with the passing of time, the onset of entropy, a symptom to which he seemed unusually sensitive. He guessed it must have something to do with his strange connection to Emily and his affinity with time itself. He didn't just see the city changing around him, but on some level was aware of the actual process, the organic alteration of the landscape. Places changed, just like people. That had been one of the most important lessons he'd learned. And London was no exception to that rule. Honoré stopped briefly by the window of a bakery store, taking in the fresh smell as they removed a tray of warm loaves from the oven, but hesitated from stepping inside when, in the reflection in the window, he caught sight of someone watching him from behind. He immediately tensed. He studied the face in the window for a moment. The man looked old, his grey beard hiding much of his face, but his eyes were bright buttons, watching Le Chasseur's back with a burrowing intensity. His long, scrawny hair was a mess of matted grime and dirt. The rest was obscured by the dazzle of sunlight on glass. Honoré turned, but the man was already across the other side of the street, looking the other way. Honoré watched him, trying to ascertain what was going on. The man looked like a tramp. His clothes were tattered and torn, and by the look of him, he had been sleeping rough, spending the nights huddled in an empty doorway or curled up on a street corner like so many other of the dispossessed who inhabited this city. His hair was a ragged brown mop, and he carried with him a small satchel that he'd slung casually over one shoulder. He looked like every other tramp Le Chasseur had seen on the streets of London since the days of the war, homeless and hungry. He took a step forward into the road, but stopped when he noticed that the man was talking to himself, or sniggering under his breath. Le Chasseur's curiosity was piqued. He could sense there was something wrong. The man was definitely mumbling something quietly into his cupped hands. He looked more closely, tried to see the man in the deeper context to which he was becoming accustomed. Each person had a time snake, a thread through history that stemmed from the moment of their birth to the time of their eventual death. Le Chasseur was sensitive to this and could see people's snakes like an aura, could read everything about them, from the impressions they had made on time, space and history, the footprint they had made on the fabric of the universe. There was something not right about this time snake, however. It stretched out in three different directions, each one ending in a tattered ribbon, as if it had been cut free from its purchase in the future or the past. These grotesque appendages curled around the man like a nest of headless serpents, Medusa-like, whipping through time as if severed from reality. In the midst of it all, he babbled to himself, seemingly unaware of what was going on around him. The man was adrift in time, out of context, and clearly out of his mind. There was something infinitely sad about him. Yet Honoré also felt a spike of danger in his presence, as if greater things were at work that he did not understand. To see someone who had just been lifted out of his own timeline, it just felt wrong. And his stomach turned at the thought of it. He turned away and started walking, unsure if he wanted to see any more. He could feel his nerves jangling, could sense the man's gaze boring holes into his back as he walked. He glanced at his watch. He was going to be late for his meeting with Emily. He ducked out of the way of a postman who was struggling with a large parcel bound for one of the local stores, and then he heard the voice ringing loudly in his ears. "Can you see it, Honoré? Can you see it now?" He stopped dead in his tracks. There was no mistaking it. It was the voice from his dream. It had come from somewhere behind him. He looked around. Nothing. It had to be the tramp. Le Chasseur ran back the way he had walked, his eyes flicking from side to side, trying to spot the severed man. He found the bakery he had been standing outside just a minute before. The man was gone. He stepped out into the middle of the road, trying to work out which direction the stranger had taken. But it was no use. It was as if he had simply disappeared, as if he had simply been swallowed by the spot he'd been standing on. Honoré shook his head, a strange creeping sensation spreading along his spine. The dream had been one thing, but things had suddenly got very strange indeed. He didn't hesitate any further. He turned around and walked as quickly as he could towards the cafe where he knew that Emily would be waiting for him. After the morning he had had, he was in need of a strong coffee. The steaming pot was filled with a cacophony of riotous sounds and the rich, distinctive smell of coffee. People bustled each other out of the way, reaching for seats or trying to catch the attention of the waitress. The chatter of voices provided a constant background hum. Le Chasseur edged his way past a row of women who were sitting by the doorway drinking tea. He caught snippets of their conversation as he stepped carefully around them.
"Our Tom gets back from Wales next week. Can I pop round for a cup of sugar this afternoon? They're rebuilding the old church round by St. Chad's Terrace, you know."
Le Chasseur smiled. Londoners.
not so different from the people of New Orleans. Emily was sitting at a small table near the back of the room. She was wearing a white blouse and her long chestnut hair was loose around her shoulders like a spray of water. In her hands, she held a mug of tea which she was sipping at in small, delicate bursts. She caught him watching her and smiled, waving for him to join her. He made his way over. Hi.
Hello, Emily.
He pulled out a chair and took a seat opposite her. Emily looked up at him and smiled, her pretty face shining in the low light of the cafe. Honoré slipped his black trench coat onto the back of his chair and rested his hat carefully on the edge of the table, moving the sugar bowl out of the way.
We need to talk.
Hold on. Emily interrupted him with a brief nod of her head. He turned around. The waitress was making a beeline for their table. Good morning, sir. What can I get for you? She wielded her notepad like a weapon.
Just coffee, please, black, no sugar. Emily?
I'm fine, thanks. She curled her fingers around the mug of tea on the table in front of her. The waitress slipped away into the throng. Emily looked up at him. You were saying? Honoré glanced back at her, exasperated.
Not here. Let's walk after we've finished our drinks.
Okay. I don't have to be anywhere today. She tried to catch his eye, concern evident on her face. Honoré looked tired. His dark skin had a faintly ashen hue to it, and there were darker patches under his eyes. His brown eyes still sparkled, though, and his beard was as immaculately trimmed as ever. Are you all right?
Yeah. Tired, that's all. I've not been sleeping too well.
Emily's eyes took on a slightly haunted glaze. Well, that's something I'm a bit of an expert on. Where shall we walk? Down to the market? A shiver ran unbidden down Le Chasseur's spine.
No, I can think of 100 places I'd rather be at the moment. Leave it to me.
He stroked his short beard, tugging the fine bristles around his chin. Moments later, his coffee arrived. He sipped at it quietly, hoping that the strong brew would help to banish some of the tiredness in his limbs. Emily was the first to break the silence. So how's Mrs. Bag of Bones? She smiled pointedly. It's been a while since I've been over.
She's well. Keeping busy in the kitchen. I haven't seen much of her myself recently. Been too tied up with other things.
That was true. He usually enjoyed sitting in the kitchen with his landlady drinking tea, but since the dreams had started a few days ago, he'd taken to locking himself in his room and avoiding contact. He knew he wasn't himself, and Emily, if anyone, would pick up on his mood, particularly after the events of that morning. Honoré downed the remains of his coffee and placed his mug pointedly on the table.
You ready?
Emily pushed her half-empty mug towards him. Yes. Let's go. Honoré retrieved his coat and hat and sprinkled a few coins on the table to pay for the coffee. On his way out, he dipped the brim of his hat at the gaggle of ladies who were still gathered around the doorway in deep conversation. Outside, the air was pregnant with the promise of rain. Le Chasseur adjusted his hat and buttoned the front of his trench coat. Emily walked beside him, her head dipped against the harsh wind. She walked close to Le Chasseur, using his bulk to shield her from the elements. So, what's been on your mind? Honoré turned to her.
Dreams. I've been having these terrible dreams.
Go on. Her smile was delicate, comforting.
I'm chasing a young boy across the city. It's late, and he keeps evading me, ducking around corners, hiding in shadows. I follow him for about 3 or 4 hours. We get as far as the marketplace at Spitalfields, and the place is deserted, no one around. At first I think I've lost track of the boy, but then I catch sight of him fleeing around another corner. I race after him, but when I get round the corner, the whole place lights up.
What do you mean? How does it light up?
It's like a brilliant, blinding flash, a hot white light that fills my entire field of vision. The whole street is just white, he indicated with his hands. That's when I see you.
Me? What am I doing there?
Just walking out of the light, towards me, like they described in the newspapers, dressed in your pink pajamas.
Honoré searched her face, trying to gauge her response.
I don't know what to make of it.
That's it? Just walking out of the light? What happens next? She was eager now, keen to find out more. Emily knew almost nothing about her own past. She had literally appeared in the marketplace a few months earlier, dressed in her nightclothes, as if she had just been plucked unwittingly from her bed. She had no idea where she had come from, or what her life had been like before she was found wandering about the marketplace lost. All she knew was that she was here, now, in London. And the only person in the whole world that she could trust was standing beside her, telling her about his dreams. She craved anything at all that might constitute a clue to her unknown past.
That's all. That's where the dream ends.
Leicester hesitated, unsure whether or not to go on.
Well, it did until last night. Last night was different. This time I felt a hand on my shoulder and a man whispering in my ear.
Emily was whispering herself. What did he say?
He said, "Can you see it, Honoré? Can you see it now?" Then everything went dark again and I woke up in a cold sweat. It felt as if someone was trying to tell me something.
Emily studied him with her bright shining eyes. I don't know, Honoré. I wouldn't read too much into all this. It's probably nothing, just a bad dream. You need to try and get some more rest. He could tell she was thinking exactly the opposite. They were walking towards Covent Garden now, and the wind was buffeting them fiercely from behind. Above them, the sky was a dirty, static colour, but the rain seemed to be holding off, waiting for some ominous moment in which to open up the heavens. People were scurrying around, darting to and fro in an attempt to avoid the bad weather. Leicester turned back towards Emily.
That's just it. Yesterday I would have agreed with you, but after this morning, I'm not so sure. I saw something on the way over to meet you that made me change my mind.
Emily stopped walking and Honoré drew up beside her. You're serious, aren't you? You think there's something going on?
Emily,
what is it? You know you can tell me. After all we've been through together in the last few months.